On behalf
Recording
of
in progress.
Cluster and Indian Academy of Sciences, I welcome fifth lecture of India Science and Technology at the Rate 75 lecture series. And today's speaker, we have Professor Sulochana Gadge. To introduce the speaker about Pune Knowledge Cluster, I welcome Professor Surendra Ghaskarji. He is the senior advisor at Pune Knowledge Cluster and heads the capacity building vertical. He is a well-known developmental biologist and has been there for several years at Agarkar Research Institute. So over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Prachi. And Professor Gadge, thank you very much for accepting to speak in this lecture series. Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure for me to introduce today's speaker. But just before that, I will give you a brief information about how the PKC Pune Knowledge Cluster was formed. The Pune Knowledge Cluster is an initiative of the Office of Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India, Professor K. Vijay Raghavan. There have several clusters have come up in India, but the Pune Knowledge Cluster was the first one to be established. And the main function of this cluster is a facilitator between various academic institutions, research institutions, and industry, and bring them together sort out or solve the problems of the Pune region, Pune and around Pune. The main verticals that Pune Knowledge Cluster concentrates on is water, environment, electric mobility, big data, and AI, artificial intelligence, and finally capacity building, wherein we try to organize events to increase the employability of the young students and PIs. The current series is this is a part of the India S&T at 75 events during the countdown of the 75th year of Indian independence. The Pune Knowledge Cluster has begun a series of lectures on scientific topics. These lectures are being organized in association with the Indian Academy of Sciences in Bangalore. And these will be delivered by fellows and associates of the Indian Academy of Sciences who are based in Pune. And these are organized in association with the Academy, as I said. The lectures will cover a wide variety of topics, ranging from cutting-edge science and technology to developments in these areas in the country over the 75 years of independence. Today, we are very fortunate to have Professor Sulochana Gadge as the speaker. She is one of the world's leading monsoon meteorologists, has made significant contributions to our understanding of the Indian monsoon and its variability, its links with atmospheric convection over tropical oceans, and the relationship of such convection with sea surface temperature. Sulochana Gadge was trained at Harvard with a PhD in applied mathematics, a postdoctoral fellow at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and later joined the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore in 1973. She played a key role in the establishment and nurturing of the Center for Atmospheric and Oceanic Sciences at IISc Bangalore and spearheaded the efforts to formulate the Indian Climate Research Program, ICRP for short. She is a recipient of several awards, including Normal Borlaug Award and Lifetime Excellence Award of Earth Sciences of 2016 from the Ministry of Earth Sciences in 2016. With this very brief introduction, I now invite Professor Gadge to deliver her talk. Professor Gadge.
Thank you very much. I would like to begin by thanking the organizers for giving me this opportunity to talk about a phenomena with which I have been involved for just about 5 decades now. And you can see that it has really, it is something very close to my heart. So I will talk about monsoon, Indian monsoon, and its variability. Now, let me begin with the beginning. In common parlance, we use the word monsoon for the system that visits us every year and gives us rain. Right? The monsoon visits us without fail year after year. This is, should be noted because it's not a common thing for atmospheric phenomena to be so reliable, but not always with the same gusto. So every summer, the question uppermost in the minds of most of the, not only meteorologists and farmers, but economists as well, is how will the monsoon behave this year? In the colonial era, the Indian economy was described as a gamble on the monsoon rains. And even today, the monsoon has a very large effect on the economy, as is seen very often in our newspapers. But we decided to do a quantitative assessment of the impact. And we found, like everything about the monsoon, the impact of monsoon on food grain production as well as on GDP is highly nonlinear. You see, the GDP or the... But when it's below average and it falls much below average, we get very, very large impact. So impacts are highly nonlinear. And this is how this occurs is another story, which I'll not get into. But what was interesting is people used to think that with so much of development, our economy will become drought-proof. But actually, we found that from 19... The impact of droughts on GDP has remained between 2-5%. There is no question of drought-proof economy. We really cannot escape the monsoon. Now, actually, in our understanding the dynamics of the tropical atmosphere and oceans, major advances have occurred, and particularly since the advent of satellites, because for the first time we can literally see the clouds over global ocean. Now, the success story of the last two decades has been the unraveling of the physics of El Nino. This is the phenomena over the Pacific, and its successful prediction with the development of realistic coupled atmosphere ocean model. So this has been the success story. Now, the next frontier is clearly the monsoon, for which the prediction of the interannual variation is still not, luck would have it, IMD came out right this year. Now, because the physics is yet to be completely unraveled, a season differs from the average rainfall. So monsoon varies a great deal from year to year, as well as within the season. There is also subseasonal variation. That is, within the monsoon, after the monsoon has set up here, we have active spells where we have a lot of rain, and we have relatively dry spells. So this is what is the subseasonal variation. And on much smaller time scales, like one day to about 4-5 days, also there is considerable variation. So now the variability of greatest concern to economists and finance ministers is the interannual variation of the Indian summer monsoon rainfall, for reasons you already saw. That is the one that has a huge impact on the countrywide food grain production and GDP. Now, long period average of this rainfall is 85 centimeters or so, and the standard deviation is only about 10% of the average. So we have to realize that although we call monsoon fickle, it is not all that variable. You know, the standard deviation is only 10% of the average, and so it's rather reliable system, okay? Now let's see how it varies anyway. Anomaly is defined as the departure from the average. So say rainfall in any year minus the average rainfall. And when we divide it by standard deviation, we get what we call the normalized anomaly. So let me show you, this is from IMD data, from 1870 to 2020. The normalized Indian summer monsoon rainfall anomaly is shown in this plot here. Just notice first and foremost how rich we are in terms of data. This is incredible that we have data over so many years and at a reasonably large number of stations. Of course, the network has increased as we went along. Now, what you see here is the departure from the mean. Okay, so above stick like this means above normal rainfall. This means above below normal rainfall. And red means that the departure is more than one standard deviation, so it's a drought. Green again means it's an excess rainfall season, too much rain. So what you see here is for more than 100 years, how the droughts and the excess rainfall seasons have varied. And I'm not going to go into it today, but you will already notice that, you know, there are clusters when you get a lot of droughts, interspersed with years when you don't get too many droughts. And again, we have a lot of droughts here. And we seem to have gotten into another such cluster rather soon, but only time will tell. So this is the year-to-year variation which we are all concerned about. I also talk, this is now rainfall average over central India. And over central India, this is like the Manhattan Towers of cricket. This is the daily rainfall that occurred over there. And this is the average for that region. And what you will see is that some spells, you have a lot of rain. Then there are weak spells or very dry spells, which we call break monsoon. And there is always a fluctuation between the two. This again is a variability we need to understand, which is very, very important for application. So understanding and predicting the variability of the monsoon itself, the physics of the monsoon, and its variability on scales ranging from subseasonal to interannual, is perhaps the most challenging problem in atmospheric science today. It is also of great applied importance because of the large impact of monsoon on agriculture and economy of the country. Now, I am happy to report here that enormous progress has been made in addressing this problem since the 80s. Particularly happy to discuss with the present understanding, since a substantive part of this work has been done by Indian scientists working at different institutions within the country. So this is the outline of the talk I'm going to give. You already heard the introduction. I have decided that everything I talk of will be defined, including things we were taught in school, like pressure, temperature, and so on. And so there will be a brief background through which I'll go very fast, of course. Then I will talk of theories of the monsoon. What is the basic system responsible for the monsoon? And we have theories right from 17th century onwards. And then, of course, the rainfall in the tropics, because that is what we are most concerned with. Then basic system responsible for the monsoon, the correct view. Special features of Indian longitude and challenges ahead. Well, first background. And this is, I'm going to go through very fast, some facts of life. We all know atmospheric pressure decreases with height, because pressure is simply the weight of the air column above any level. Now, atmospheric temperature also decreases with height. Now, that is not obvious because the main energy of the atmosphere comes from the sun. And the sun is way up above. But the reason that atmospheric temperature decreases with height is that the solar radiation passes almost unhampered through our atmosphere and gets absorbed at the surface of the earth, whether land or ocean. And it is radiation from the earth that heats the atmosphere. So the atmosphere is heated from below. This is why the temperature also decreases. And this is an important thing, the lapse rate. The rate at which the temperature decreases, you know, determines the stability of the atmosphere. And the lapse rate normally is about 6 degrees centigrade per kilometer. We all know that at hill stations of 1 kilometer high, the temperature is less by about 6 degrees. Now, some parts of the Earth's surface are hotter than others. See, we have already seen that atmospheric circulation arises because of heating from below. Okay, but the heating is not uniform in space. Some parts of the Earth's surface are hotter than others, and which parts are hotter depends on the season. This is all well known. Also, land gets hotter than ocean for the same insulation. This is because radiation is absorbed by a very thin layer of land, whereas it goes to heat a large layer in the ocean. So land gets hotter than ocean, and some parts of the earth, some latitudes will be warmer than others, depending on the considerable variation with season of surface winds. And these are the monsoonal regions of the world he has identified. You can see it goes from Africa, India, Asia, and includes Australia as well. So we have the African monsoon, the Asian monsoon, and the Australian monsoon. Now, so these are the monsoonal regions of the world based on surface winds. Okay, now, theories of the monsoon. See, just as the critical feature of the monsoon for the sailors was the direction of the surface winds, The focus of most of the early theories of the monsoon was on the monsoon winds, that is circulation. Why is there a variation with season? So the problem of what is the basic system responsible for the monsoon was first addressed in 1686 by Edmund Halley, better known for the comet. Okay. And he suggested that the primary cause of the monsoon was the differential heating between ocean and land. In other words, in Halley's view, the monsoon is a gigantic land-sea breeze arising from land-ocean contrast in surface temperature. So this is a land-sea breeze. We have ocean and land is hotter than the ocean. And because of that, a low pressure will get created here and the wind will flow towards the low here, ascend and go back at higher levels. This is the land-sea breeze, okay? And what Halley perceived was that the monsoon is a gigantic land-sea breeze, okay? Now, question is, so the basic question in atmospheric circulation is, what is the response of an atmosphere which is heated from below, okay? And this is the same thing that Halley is trying to propose by imposing a land-ocean contrast, imposing a temperature gradient in the heating from below. Okay, now this, for a minute, if we forget the rotation of the Earth, this becomes just the classical problem of Baynard convection in fluid mechanics. It is the so-called porridge problem. Okay, the porridge problem is the following, that response of a fluid depends on how large is the temperature gradient relative to the viscosity and conductivity of the fluid. This is measured by a non-dimensional parameter, the Rayleigh number. Okay, so when the viscous effects dominate, like if you have very thick sambar, then as soon as you switch on your gas, there is no convection. The sambar gets burnt over the hot part of the bottom plate. Okay, so if viscous effects dominate, you will not get circulation. So circulation driven by land-sea contrast in temperature is expected to be similar to this Baynard convection at high Rayleigh numbers, okay, where viscous effects are overcome by the heat temperature gradient. So if you have a hot plate which is hot in this part, and this is the solution, fluid mechanics solution of the Baynard convection problem, what you will have is rising over the hot plate, just like we said about the land-sea breeze, and the air rising here diverges at higher levels and comes back. So this is the temperature thing. So we have ascent over the hotter region here. Okay, this is the solution of the Baynard convection problem. Now, what is the situation with the Indian summer monsoon? See, this is the situation in July. This is the climatological map, which means it's the average over 100 years or so. And what you see is contours are pressure, okay? So this is low pressure, and this is all this is low pressure relative to the rest. Higher pressure towards the south and lower pressure here, lowest being here. This is the called the trough, okay? So what happens in the during our summer monsoon is that lowest pressure occurs here because of the heating of the subcontinent. And this implies that there is a north-south pressure gradient, right? So by Baynard convection ideas, we should have winds only from south to north flowing into the trough, okay? But there is a problem in using things which have no rotation in them. And this was pointed out by Hadley, who said that we are dealing with very large-scale systems. See, this is thousands of kilometers. And so for such large-scale systems, rotation of the Earth is important. So we have to take into account Coriolis force, which arises from the rotation of the Earth. And what it will mean is that winds that are going from south to north will acquire a component from west to east. It turns to the right. I don't want to get into details here, but with the Coriolis force, we will get, in fact, exactly what we wanted. We will get southwest winds over the Arabian Sea and in the summer, and northeast winds in the winter when the pressure gradient reverses. So the seasonality of the winds at the surface can be in fact explained by a Halley's theory of land-sea breeze model, provided we take rotation of the earth into account, as Hadley suggested. But winds are as far as they go, but they don't go far enough as far as we are concerned. We are more concerned about rainfall. So now how do we get rainfall? And how do we understand the seasonality of rainfall? The fact that on Indian region, it falls mainly in the summer monsoon. Now we get rainfall from clouds, which we all know. And these are pictures of the India original rain-giving systems, which is clouds. So this is cumulus congestus, this is nimbus, which is raining. And if you draw the vertical thing, you can see they are very, very deep. And they extend to levels at which not only do you get water droplets, but you get ice as well, right? Definition of a cloud is a blob in which water vapor gets converted to water. And when clouds go very high, there is also ice in them. So these are very deep clouds that give us monsoon rain. And typically, they are 4 to 6 kilometers in horizontal extent. This is each cumulus cloud. Each cloud that gives us rain is only 4 to 6 kilometers in horizontal extent. And we experience rain from single clouds during thunder showers in the pre-monsoon, April, May. आपण त्याला वळवाचा पाऊस म्हणतो आणि असंही म्हणतात की वळवाच्या पावसाने बैलाचं एक शिंग विस्तन दुसरं कोरडं राहतं. दिस शोज व्हॉट अ स्मॉल स्केल सिस्टम इट इज दॅट द बाउंड्री हॅज अकर्ड ऑन द फोरहेड ऑफ द बुलक. ओके, सो सिंगल क्लाउड रेन इज रेअर बट वी डू एक्सपिरियन्स इट. बट मोस्ट ऑफन ड्युरिंग द मान्सून सीझन सच क्लाउड्स आर ऑर्गनाइज इन क्लाउड सिस्टम्स with scales of hundreds of kilometers, synoptic scale system, the so-called lows, depressions. Now, this is a system that you must have all read about in the newspaper. This is the so-called gulab, which came over us 24th September to 27th September. This is the track of the system. It was born over the bay and it crossed and then came here. And this is the way IMD predicts from this point what is the possible envelope of the tracks it could take. Okay, so this is IMD prediction, and these days these are coming rather good. So this is how it looks like. There are hundreds and hundreds of clouds embedded in one system. They're all organized. See, this is 1,000 kilometers, mind you, and each cumulus cloud is only 5 kilometers. So lots of clouds are embedded in it, and furthermore, these synoptic scale systems or cloud blobs are themselves embedded in very large scale, planetary scale system, which you see here. You see, these are over thousands of kilometers. And what you see is organization of the synoptic scale over thousands of kilometers. Okay. So actual rainfall occurs not generally through a single cloud, but through cloud systems in which clouds are organized over very large scale. Now, question is, how do clouds arise? Physics of clouds. Okay, now here with that in brief, this is actually pressure and this is height. And this is, suppose now we know that pressure decreases with height. So suppose we took a parcel of air and let it be dry, let it not have any water vapor, and raised it to another level B, adiabatically, giving no energy to it. Then what will happen? Since it's at a lower pressure level, it will expand. Okay, but it has to do it with its own energy because it's adiabatic ascent, so it will cool. Okay, so adiabatic ascent of dry air leads to cooling. Now question is, how cold is it relative to the environment? Okay. Now, it so happens that this adiabatic ascent implies that the dry air will cool at the rate of 10 degrees per centigrade, 10 degrees centigrade per kilometer. But we have seen that atmosphere temperature decreases at 6 degrees per kilometer. So this parcel will always be colder than the surrounding atmosphere, and hence denser, and hence will return to the original level due to restoring buoyancy. So a dry parcel of air in the tropics, if raised adiabatically, will return to its original position. This is to say, this indicates stability, right? Because the vertical displacement is actually decreases with time. So tropical atmosphere is stable with respect to vertical ascent of dry parcel. But consider now, if the parcel is moist and not dry, and we anyway force it to ascend from A to B, okay, adiabatic ascent. As it cools, what happens? Its relative humidity increases. And at the level of lifting condensation, as meteorologists call it, it reaches 100%. So it becomes saturated at the level of lifting condensation as it keeps cooling. And if the moist parcel is pushed adiabatically beyond this level, then water vapor is converted to liquid water and latent heat of condensation is released. This prevents it from cooling as rapidly as a dry parcel would. In fact, it cools at a rate of 4.5 degrees centigrade per kilometer, which is lower than the environmental lapse rate of 6. Okay? So it is going to find itself warmer and lighter than the environment and will keep on moving upward because of the buoyancy force. So this indicates instability. So the tropical atmosphere is unstable with respect to vertical displacement of moisture beyond the lifting condensation level. Okay? And this is what we call conditional instability, because it is stable with respect to vertical displacement of dry air, but unstable with respect to vertical displacement of moisture. This is called conditionally unstable, and our tropical atmosphere is conditionally unstable. So in a conditionally unstable atmosphere, in regions of ascending air, whenever the ascent is sustained beyond the level of condensation, then cumulus clouds can arise. Because once you get condensation, you get water. And that is in fact clouds. So you get cumulus clouds in this conditionally unstable atmosphere. So cumulus clouds are thus a manifestation of gravitational instability and convective overturning in an atmosphere whose lowermost layer is moist. Clearly, for genesis of deep clouds associated with monsoon rainfall, it is essential to have strong enough ascent of sufficiently moist air. Okay? Without that, you won't get rain. Now, let us see what the average circulation looks like. Okay? This is Indian longitude 70 to 90. If you averaged it, then these are latitude and this is the height or pressure level. The vertical velocity and meridional or north-south velocities are plotted here. What you will see is ascend in the, this is for July. So there is an ascending zone in northern hemisphere, descending zone in southern hemisphere, and in between the cell is completed. But the important thing to notice is that this is extending right through the troposphere. This is 200 HPM. Okay? So it is several kilometers above the surface. So this, our clouds lead to the cell, which extends through the entire troposphere. Now the question is, Halley had his theory of land-sea contrast, right? So given land-sea contrast, how deep will the cell be if you force from temperature from the ground? Very interesting study by Schneider and Lindzen of an idealized axially symmetric state model, in which they forced by temperature gradient at the surface and which varied with latitude. And what they found is that these surface temperatures can only drive shallow cells. Okay? So this cell, you have ascent over the heated zone, but the ascent is not beyond 2 kilometers or so. Then it spreads and it descends. So there are very shallow cells which this temperature can generate. And this is what we call a heat loop in meteorology. Now, so we have to note that although Halley's theory, after taking into account modification by Hadley, can explain the seasonal variation of the direction of surface wind, however, the circulation force by the surface temperature gradient is shallow and thus incapable of simulating the rainfall on the subcontinent or its seasonal variation. Since the rainfall is the most important attribute of the monsoon system over the Indian region, Halley's theory of the primary cause of the monsoon being land-ocean contrast is simply not acceptable. Now, over the years, several eminent meteorologists have expressed reservations about the theory. I don't have time to go into, but very beautiful quotations, right from 1884, 1921, and so on, all of which you will find in a detailed review paper I wrote in 2018, if anybody is interested. So all I'm saying is that not everybody was happy with this land-sea contrast theory. And now there is conclusive proof that the observations of the temporal variation of the monsoon rainfall are not consistent with the assumption that major driving force is land-ocean contrast. In fact, the strongest relationship is higher the rainfall, lower the temperature over land. This is what we experience also in the rainy season. The days without rain are hotter than rainy days. So clearly, rather than land surface temperature determining the amount of rainfall, via the impact on the difference between land and ocean temperature, the land temperature itself is determined by the rainfall or lack thereof. So in other words, the observations are not consistent with the land-sea breeze hypothesis. Yet, the monsoon has, since the 18th century, been considered to be the response of an atmosphere on a rotating Earth to land-ocean contrast in surface temperature heating. This is what we are taught in school, if you remember, and is also believed by a majority of people, scientists and also meteorologists. Now, in some of the recent papers on climate change, infer the changes in monsoon induced by global warming using this land-sea breeze theory. I have written quite often and now say here again that it is high time we bury this theory once and for all, okay? And so what is the alternative theory? For basic system responsible for the monsoon, it lies in the dynamics of synoptic and planetary scale systems of clouds. See, Schneider and Lindzen, when they heated from below and they found only a shallow cell, they knew, as I showed you, that the tropical circulation is a deep cell. So there is something wrong in this. So what they showed was, if we introduce another heat source in the mid-troposphere here, that is to say, this is 300 millibar or so, so beyond 5-6 kilometers, if we introduce another heat source, then you get another cell like this, and that makes the total vertical cell deeper, okay? This is what we call dynamic low. That is, if the ascent triggers latent heat of condensation, which in turn heats the atmosphere, you will get a deep cell. And this is what we call a dynamic low. So this is also occurring over a low pressure region, but it's a dynamic low, which leads to a deep cell driven by a heat source in the mid-troposphere. And if we look at July, again, climatological July map, this is our pressure and these are the winds, okay? And what you will see is that over Rajasthan, there is a heat low. This is a very shallow cell. How do I know it? Because rainfall is here and there's hardly any rain over that region, you see? So the rain occurs over this part. This is also a low pressure region. So this is where rain occurs. It is associated with what we call a dynamic low and heat low. Heat low doesn't have any rain at all, okay? So in nature, these two solutions, in fact, occur side by side, heat low and dynamic low. And actually, if we plot the vertical cell now, this is 60 to 70, so that is where Rajasthan's longitudes are. And what you get is actually a shallow cell going south to north and coming back around 3 kilometers. Okay? Whereas this is central India, 78 to 88. And what you get is a very deep cell which goes right up to 200 millibar and several kilometers, 12, 14 kilometers, and then returns in the north. So we see heat law and dynamic law side by side. Now, actually, we still don't understand completely how you get this transition in space or time between heat law and dynamic law. Now, during hot months of April and May, what we have over India is a heat law. Okay, there's no rain and it gets very hot. But onset of monsoon over Kerala heralds the arrival of the monsoon cloud band over the subcontinent, which subsequently moves across the country to establish the dynamic low associated with monsoon rainfall. So this is one example of temporally how heat low gets converted to dynamic low. Again, intense dry spells in the peak monsoon months of July and August are also associated with a heat low over the monsoon zone. And revival to active conditions involves transformation to dynamic low with propagation of cloud systems from equatorial Indian Ocean or Bay of Bengal. So now let us then look at clouds, cloud systems, and conditional instruments. See, we have seen that the tropical atmosphere is conditionally unstable. It has also been shown by stability analysis that 4 to 6 kilometer scale, which is the scale of the cumulus cloud, is the fastest growing scale in the conditionally unstable atmosphere. So like any instability problem, we expect this scale to dominate, right? But that is not what we see. What we see is that these clouds are organized over many, much larger scale. So one of the basic problems of tropical convection addressed in the 60s was to understand how the clouds are organized over synoptic and planetary scales. How could convection over the larger scales be selected for? Since in a moist tropical atmosphere, the cumulus scale must always win in the competition. So if we started a perturbation with all scales, it is the cumulus scale which will win, right? That's what the stability analysis says. Well, the short answer provided by Charney, whose name you will hear again and again because he was a genius, and he is the one who provided the short answer. The mantra in the multi-scale interaction is cooperation rather than competition. Now, why is it possible? It is possible because of special attributes of large-scale low-pressure systems on a rotating Earth. See, on a rotating Earth, cyclonic vorticity, which is vorticity of the same sign as the Earth below, a rotation of the Earth below, results in convergence in the boundary layer, air coming together here at the lower level and ascent. Okay, so this is a property of rotating fluids. Now, if you notice winds and vorticity patterns of all these lows and so on that we keep seeing on weather maps, you will find that they are actually vortices. And their vortices are anticlockwise, which is the same sign as the rotation of the Earth. So these are cyclonic vortices. Okay, above the boundary layer, and they will lead to ascent of air from the boundary layer. So what happens is the following. We have positive feedback between synoptic, planetary, and cumulus scale. Such cyclonic vortices are associated with convergence in the boundary layer and ascent of the moist. Now, ascent of moist air, what will it do? It will lead to genesis of clouds over the entire region where there is ascent, right? Then that leads to heating the atmosphere due to release of latent heat of condensation, which in turn, what would it do? It would lower the pressure of the low pressure system. And that is to say, it will intensify the system, means increase the convergence, and you will have more ascent and more clouds. So there is a positive feedback between the ascent created by the vortices, your lows and depressions and so on, and the clouds themselves. This positive feedback, of course, doesn't go on forever. No instability goes on forever in nature. What happens is that clouds, by heating the mid-troposphere, have an impact on the very instability that feeds them, okay, by decreasing the instability. And that leads to break in convection. We are back to cloud-free condition, and the cycle begins. So this is the way we have interaction between cumulus cloud and larger scale system. Now, the system associated with east-west cloud bands, this system, very beautiful cloud bands almost girdling the earth, is called a tropical convergence zone. Why? Because convergence at the lower level is a key dynamical property. So this is a tropical convergence zone. And where the convergence occurs due to air from south and north hemisphere, it is called intertropical convergence. So ITCZ or tropical convergence zone. Now, we didn't know too much about the physics of ITCZ also till the 70s. And theory of the ITCZ incorporate, this is one of the first pictures of the ITCZ from satellite. This is ITCZ over Pacific with a low that formed and then took off as a cyclone from there. All cyclones are born in this tropical convergence zone. So, theory of the ITCZ incorporating this feedback was developed by Charney. Okay? And now we know that tropical circulation is a response to heating of the surface due to insulation from the sun. Net solar radiation at the top varies with latitude, being maximum at the latitude where sun is overhead. So sun is overhead, northernmost location in June, July, and southernmost in January. So that is where heating is maximum. Okay? So from this we can understand and get a simple theory of tropical circulation that you have because of, suppose we now forget seasons and hold the sun fixed over the equator, then we'll get a low pressure region over the equator and we will get these kind of winds, again, same as Halley's thing. And in addition, you will have ascent here and this ascent will lead to clouds and the ITCZ. So this is the vertical circulation. And these are the surface winds, idealized surface winds, which are the trades, northeast and southeast. So very similar theory as we had done earlier, but this time for the tropical circulation. Okay, so Charney's zeroth order model for axisymmetric component of tropical circulation and rainfall and the ITCZ was Baynard convection rising from solar heating varying with latitude plus rotation of the earth plus the positive feedback I just described between clouds and organized rainfall, okay? Now, we were still puzzled about what is the basic system responsible for the monsoon because we had realized that the land-sea theory doesn't hold good. So, in 77, it so happened that Charney visited India. And I had a discussion with him and he suggested to me to start looking at satellite pictures, which had just then become available. The first pictures were from 73 onwards that we had, and to get insight into the monsoon. I think he had a hunch that it would be, the basic system would be seen on the satellite. Now, it so happened that Sikha, who was one of the most knowledgeable monsoon meteorologists, was already my collaborator, and he was trained in satellite meteorology. So we immediately embarked on a study of daily satellite meteorology imagery over the Indian region and actually could suggest in the late 70s an alternative theory for the monsoon. So we now have an alternative theory for the monsoon. According to the alternative hypothesis, the system that is responsible for the monsoon rainfall is the same as the system which gives rainfall over the tropical Atlantic, Pacific, etc., which is the intertropical convergence zone. So the system is not different, but amplitude of seasonal variation is large over land than it is over the ocean parts. And thus the monsoon is a manifestation of the seasonal variation of the tropical circulation and rainfall in response to seasonal rainfall variation of the sun. Now, how much more time do I have, Dr. Ghaskodbi? Hello? Hello?
Perhaps another few minutes, if you can. Yeah.
Okay, I'll finish in 10.
Yes, okay. Thank
you. I've just come to the crux of the lecture.
No problem.
This is the January rainfall. And you see, in January, the main rain belt is to our south here over the ocean. And this is July. And July, you see, the band has come to visit us. So now it is known that this equatorial trough actually follows the sun by about 2 months lag. Now we, in our study, provided support for the theory that the basic system of the monsoon was nothing other than ITCB. And we could see that satellite pictures, it looked very similar. But, you know, one can't go by looks alone. We also, of course, checked the dynamical characteristics of ITCC were the same as what is the in the monsoon. And we showed that all the critical features like intense convergence in the lower troposphere, cyclonic vorticity above, etc., etc., were actually present in the monsoon system. And if we look at satellite pictures, then you will see the migration of the ITCG onto India. So what this is in March, where you see a nice band over the Indian Ocean. Now, this is during our onset. And you see onset, it has come here. And this is after it got established. This is how it looks like. And this is on 8th October, yesterday. And this is, you still see the ITCG here, but it has retreated from major portion of India, okay? And after retreat, 18th October, some other year, this is actually the place where it has come. So the seasonal variation we see in rainfall is just a manifestation of migration of this system which comes over us. Okay? But we also found that there are some special features of the Indian region, okay, which are not there for other monsoonal regions. And this is a very important one because we found that there are two favorable locations for the ITCG, one over the subcontinent here and the other here. So even after the ITCG gets established here, another system, another ITCG will keep appearing intermittently over here. And this is a very amazing thing because there are two favorable locations, one over the warm equatorial Indian Ocean and the other over our region. Okay? And there is also competition between the two. You see, in the middle of the monsoon season, this has become weak. And suddenly you see beautiful ITCG, similar to what we saw in spring, appear here over the ocean. Same thing here, 22nd August this year. This is 3rd August this year. So this is the monthly average picture. What you see is the primary band, and this is the seasonally migrating thing which gives us the monsoon. And there is a secondary band, which is the oceanic system. Okay, and you see it reflected also in the mean precipitation. That main precipitation in July is here. But there is a secondary band here over the ocean, okay? Now, the other feature we found is that at interval of 2 to 6 weeks, we keep on getting northward propagation of this band onto the heated continent, okay? So this occurs all the time, sometimes at the interval of 4 weeks, sometimes at 2 weeks. And this is something that occurs year after year. Now, such propagations of rain belts across India during onset phase has been very well known. Kalidasa's Meghaduta talks exactly about that. You know, he's telling Meghaduta to go north to his lover and give a message. Okay? But that they occur throughout the season, nobody had expected in this study. Okay? So now, revival from weak spells occurs often with this propagation. So oceanic ITC is not just unfavorable. It competes with our cloud band, but it also helps by sustaining our cloud band through this propagation. So all these interactions are very complicated. Main thing is because we have multiple equilibria, right? You have two possible solutions of the Navier-Stokes equation. One is that the ascending region could be primarily over land, and the other could be over the ocean. And in nature, it's a combination of both. But models have a very difficult time in getting this kind of solution. Okay? And this is why it is more difficult to model Indian monsoon than it is the other monsoonal region where there is a clean migration and not this kind of a thing. Now, other thing is, of course, we have now said that we should not have a parochial theory of the monsoon being land-ocean contrast. The system is a more general system which is present everywhere in the tropics, which also means it has different, different expectations for feedbacks. So the kind of thing you expect from land-ocean theory will be totally different from this in terms of cloud radiation feedbacks and so on. I think that this PPT will be available to anybody who would like, I think, from the organizers. So I have almost run out of time, and I have come to the most critical part, which is teleconnection, for which I have very little time left. So I'm going to rush through. And I think the take-home lesson so far has been that we have learned a great deal about the physics of the monsoon, and we will learn more about the variability also by looking at the ITCG physics and the satellite cloud pictures, okay? And so ENSO connection, again, just one slide to give you an idea of the interannual variation. This is correlation of outgoing long wave radiation measured by satellite, which is a measure of the how high the clouds are. So this shows clouds are high over India and same time here. And at the same time, they are suppressed here. This link is very strong. This is the link of monsoon with ENSO. And this is the link of monsoon with equatorial Indian Ocean. And both these modes play a very important role. I don't have time to go into it, but all I can say is that if only we could predict both of them. Right now, we can predict ENSO. If we could have predicted EQUIN, then we would have been able to explain a very large part of the variance by a composite index. The correlation coefficient is 0.73. Okay. That these forecasts are wrong primarily because our models are right now sensitive only to ENSO. We don't have the right connections with the Indian Ocean clouding. And once we get it, we should have improved. So with this, I'm going to stop. That unless we can completely understand both the modes and simulate them with models, we will not be able to understand the interannual variation nor predict it. I think I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Gadgil. Such a complex topic you have covered in such a short time. Very nice. I saw some time back a couple of very interesting questions and a comment in the chat box. Prachi, will you take over? Or perhaps Rashmi can ask her question directly? I don't know.
Yes, Rashmi ma'am can directly ask, actually.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, Professor Gadgil, for wonderful presentation. I have two questions which I have posted there also. My first question is related to instances of cloudburst. What actually happens when the cloudburst actually takes place? Is it what is the phenomenon that is associated with cloudburst?
This is a very, very complicated question. And actually, I will direct you to one of my colleagues, Professor Bhatt, to tell you all about cloudbursts.
Okay.
It's a difficult thing to predict. It is, you know, it is this mesoscale or small-scale convection. You know, it is not these big systems that I showed, you know, lows and depressions and all. They give much less rain. Now, you will see in Pune, 2-3 days ago, we had a lot of rain. And that was not with the whole system coming over us, but just a few clouds, mesoscale system. So those are far more intense. And take it, you know, it is no different from any other single cloud rain. But to predict it becomes very difficult. See, as it is, these models are not able to predict intensity of rain.
Right.
You know, they can predict that the rain may occur. But this is a tough question. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. And my second question is, artificial rains are being attempted in recent times. Does it have any impact on the natural equilibrium of monsoon rains, or for that matter, any rain, or natural rain?
Actually, I have a very strong views on artificial rain. First and foremost, it is extremely difficult to demonstrate unequivocally that it has rained because you put some salt in the clouds. Okay, that's what they do. They throw some salt or something else in the clouds. And if it rains, they will give it to whatever they have done. What if it doesn't rain? And how do you know the cloud wouldn't have rained without your interference? Okay, so statistically, this is a very tough issue to sort out. You need a lot of sample to do that. And I find our problem in India and perhaps elsewhere also is that we are not using enough information on climate variability to adjust our systems, okay? What is the point of trying to enhance rainfall? In every rain system, in every kind of zone, it is possible to have productive systems, agriculture, horticulture, so on and so forth. Instead of adjusting to the observed climate variability, you know, it is the arrogance, human arrogance, which says, I will create the rain. Or I will, first of all, I'll build cities which cannot really sustain, be sustained on the given water supply. So I will make rain for it. Now, so I think it is a little bit ridiculous that we are not doing our homework with the kind of knowledge there is of, we have, I showed you more than 100 years of data at many places, but we are not using that to in any way optimize. And instead of that, trying to interfere and trying to make artificial rain, no harm done. But I have not been convinced by what I have seen so far that it's a successful venture.
Right, Professor. Thank you very much for that clarification.
Go ahead, Prachi.
Yeah, so we have one more question from Mr. Ranjan Kirkar. And he's asking that, do the 1st June and 30th September dates for rainfall accounting need to change?
See, Dr. Kelkar has been one of the people responsible for the monsoon as director of DG of IMD for many years. And it's very amusing that he should ask me this question. Actually, Dr. Kelkar, I am not sure it is worth putting in effort to change those dates, because again, we will have to analyze very carefully this 100-year data to see whether there is a better way to define. And given that we are not able to get it, see, Goswami had an idea about defining with tropospheric heating and so on and so forth. Many people try the ideas, but I agree with you that the monsoon does not get, you know, onset doesn't necessarily occur in June, and certainly doesn't seem to be retreating in September. But whether by changing the dates, we will really gain, I don't know, more than for every year determining the season ourselves on the research mode. But Dr. Kelkar, I, as I said, this is not a question I can answer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your comment. One comment I had, I really like that analogy with the sambar. That was very nice. Thank you so much.
Prachi, I think there is another question.
Yeah. So there is one more question. Manjusha madam, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Actually, madam, thank you very much for your valuable speech here. So I am a teaching faculty here in Pune. Madam, just it is a curiosity for, I have asked you a question. Currently from last 2 to 3 years, the flood situation, whatever generating, especially in Maharashtra, we have heard in Pune, Kolhapur, as well as, and whatever the before, I think so, 8 days, the flood situation that happened in Vidarbha, wherever in Marathwada, where when never rain comes to such intense situation and flood situation was generated. But what my observation is that in Pune, during the daytime, though, there is diverse temperature fluctuations, like morning cold, then afternoon heating, again evening, again there is raining. So from last 1 to 2 months, these are the observations. Constantly temperature is fluctuating within the day. Sometimes we feel hot, sometimes we feel cold. So just it is a curiosity I'm asking, madam, are these the temperature fluctuations can be the main reason behind these flood situations, especially in Maharashtra like states? Yeah.
You know, see, the problem with monsoon is that when we say last few months it has happened, If you look at the data, you will find many years where it has happened before. So it's not clear that this is a sign of any climate change or anything. This is part of the deal. I mean, in Pune, we always talk of October heat, right? October heat, and the system is really not on us. Then you tend to get, just like in pre-monsoon, where with the heating of land itself, you can get intense precipitation with some clouds. And that seems to be happening again. But this year, a little bit unusual is that the cloud band also is moving northward much more. Now, the whole problem with the monsoon is it is very difficult to deduce that these are, you know, long-term changes happening. Because every time you look at data, and even satellite data now we have from 82 onwards. So 30, 40 years of data is there. Every time you look at it, you will find umpteen other examples where this has happened. So it is a matter of our describing the system better. And as far as floods are concerned, I think it is entirely due to the way we manage our land resources and our water resources. You now, Mumbai had so many rivers, all of them were buried. What do you expect the rain to do? It will go where it used to. You know, you can't expect nature to obey you and let water go where you have made the ways. So same way, you go on building up things and not allowing water to flow is not going to help. And these floods that we are creating is entirely due to this. Plus, there is another thing. We have reservoirs. And if you have noticed in newspapers also, every time there is an intense shower, these reservoirs start releasing water. So they enhance what would have been a natural flood many times. And this is because they don't want to release ahead of time with a fear that it may not fill. So they are trying to maximize their chance of, you know, maximum storage, but in the process, creating floods for you and me. So there are a lot of problems with floods. But I have a feeling with the rain that comes, what we are doing is simply not a rational and reasonable way of managing it.
May I just say so something much. Here? You know, the lady who has asked this question may also listen to Professor Madhav Gadgil's lecture, which he gave in the same forum a couple of months back. And he was asked about the Chipulun floods. And he really dealt in detail with that, how, you know, interference of humankind is, you know, often responsible for these floods, as Professor Sulochana Gadgil just mentioned. So you may want to listen to Professor Madhav Gadgil. It is available on YouTube, isn't it, Prachi?
Available on YouTube.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Vilam. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Have any questions, like more questions on the chat box? So thank you so much, ma'am. It was a wonderful lecture. I thank you on behalf of Pune Knowledge Cluster and also all the participants for joining this session. So thank you all.
Yes. Recording stopped.